follow the style, and inshallah we hope that you will learn and you will inshallah have a broader understanding of Sharia matters. Of course it's important that we understand and that we implement. And we have selected the Surah Al-Hujurat, which is of course the chambers in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam abided in where he lived. And this Surah speaks about very, very many issues, which is of course very, very relevant to the times that we live in. And one might think, you know, why the Surah? Why this topic? What is so important about, you know, brotherhood, uhuwa, how one should have, you know, relationship with our fellow brothers. And this topic came up because I am definitely not, you know, I haven't been that long to observe, you know, the issues that we have in the area, but we will just generalize it and speak about the importance of uhuwa, unity. And I might have thought, you know, to get to speak about the topic, to get people, you know, to attend the salah more regularly, on a regular basis. That is also important, but if there are issues that, you know, that need to be addressed, then I think this is a very, very important issue. The unity of one of the brothers. And here we're not only referring to unity amongst the South Africans or unity amongst the Bangladeshi brothers or Pakistani brothers or the Arabs and so on, but more general, being Muslimin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it incumbent upon us not to be divided, but to be a united ummah. Inna hadihi ummatukum ummatan wahida. Allah Ta'ala says, then this ummah is but a united ummah, one ummah. There's no division. There is no division amongst us based maybe on race, maybe based on color or creed, nothing of that sort. We are a united ummah. Verily, this is one united ummah, and I am your Lord, says Allah Ta'ala in the Quran. وَأَنَا رَبُّكُمْ فَاعْبُدُونَ, and worship me. So much so, in fact, this has been a issue since the very time when Islam was initially spread amongst the Quraysh. Certain people thought that they were better than the others, and others thought that they were better than them, we are better than them, and they thought they were better than us, and so on. To the extent that many wars also, you know, took place because of that. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commented on this, and he says in a very beautiful hadith, لا فضل لعربي على عجمي ولا لعجمي على عربي ولا لأبيض على أسود ولا لأسود على أبيض إلا بالتقوى الناس من آدم وآدم من تراب. He says, you know, there is no, you know, if any one of you might think that you are better, there is no superiority for the black upon the white, because this was the issue that time already. Certain people thought that they were better than the others. So much so that one of the people, one of the Sahaba said to Bilal ibn Rabah, who was a pitch black Abyssinian slave, said to him, Yaban al-Sawda, you know, oh, the son of a black person. This really, you know, brought anger in the heart of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, "How dare you say that? And he said to him, this man regretted so much what he said, and he put his face onto the ground and he said to Bilal, you put your foot on my face, if that will make you feel better. But I am so deeply sorry, you know, for what I have mentioned to you. Prophet ﷺ became so angry. This was the reaction. So here the Prophet ﷺ says, La fadla, there's no superiority for an Arab upon a non-Arab. The Arabs don't tell you, you know, we are better than you. This is what we call, these are statements of Jahiliyyah, ignorant statements. And we better not tell them also that we are better than them. And if we might be, you know, light in complexion, the white, we are light in complexion, we are better than you, or the white is more superior towards the black, or the blacks might think that they are more superior upon the non-blacks or the whites. They are all, you know, practicing a form of jahiliyyah, of ignorance. And Islam came to abolish that. Islam came to make away with all that. You know, racism, thinking the one is better than the other one. So that's why Prophet ﷺ ends off that hadith and he says, "An-nasu min Adam," we are all from Adam. We are all from Adam. Wa Adam min turab. And Adam was made, he was created from clay. He was created from dust, from sand, dust. So my dear brothers, let us understand that. And the Prophet ﷺ, you know, when Allah Ta'ala described him, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ Ya Rasulullah, you were sin, and you had the best of character. The best of character. And he said by himself, when he described himself, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ I was sent to complete the character of mankind. So, if you do not, you know, implement this, then you really got to ask yourself, are you really fit to live in the times that you are living in as Muslimin? And if you do fall short of that, then you've really got to, you know, sit and ponder upon, you know, yourself. And go back to these ayahs that we have mentioned today. Start with the first ayah, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا It all starts, you know, with the misunderstandings that we sometimes have about one another. And this is not an issue that is only happening, you know, amongst the, if I must be specific, or to say, Eastern Africans, or this is an international issue. You know, people think that they are better than the others. That is why the Americans might think that they are better than the Africans and so on. This is the issue, a global issue. That we've got to Islam address this already 1,400 years ago. 1,400 years ago, this was addressed by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it all starts sometimes, you know, with how we interpret one another. And these are issues, you know, these are things that happens. Allah Ta'ala says, إِن جَاءَكُمْ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا O people of faith, people of iman. إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ إِنَبَأَ فَتَبَيَّنَ Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says, and if a fasiq comes to you, a fasiq, which is, you know, someone who might not be on the level of iman as he ought to be, weak of iman, the mere fact that he comes to you to relate about someone else already displays himself, what type of person he is. Because we do not carry around news from the one to the other in order to create fiction upon, you know, amongst ourselves. And if that type of person comes to you, then we have to go deeper into that. Look, you know, or listen to what, if you are prepared to listen to what he wants to relate to you, do not react upon what you hear immediately. Because that can create one of the greatest problems for yourself and those who are on your side. إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. Allah Ta'ala says, and verify first that what was brought to you. Verify the news. And this is where, unfortunately, many of us goes wrong. Where they immediately take action with what they hear from one another. And here Allah Ta'ala says, إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ. If a fasiq comes to you, then do not immediately take action, but verify first the news that he brings to you. Because if you might take action on what you've heard from him, you might create yourself a bigger problem. فَتُصِيبُ قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if a fasiq comes to you with any news, I have got to be with you, verify, lest you should harm people in ignorance, and afterwards you become regretful for what you have done. It all stems from there. How you react towards that person who brings about to yourself, you know, who relates to you certain news. And of course the best is to come to the Quran. If it happens so that there are friction between two different parties, what is the duty of the Muslim in order to bring about peace and harmony and unity and love amongst them? Is it the right attitude for anyone to just to say, khalas, that is not my problem, it's theirs, or leave it over to the sheikh will have to handle that? Wrong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses each and every one. If you're a Muslim, you have a responsibility and you have a duty by Allah. And here Allah ta'ala says, in wa in ta'ifatani min al-mu'minin iqtatalu فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيءَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if two parties among the believers fall in fighting, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. أَصْلِحُوا means that you have to bring peace between the two of you. And this is something that we sometimes, you know, neglect in a very, very big way. Because we tend to, you know, we say, well, this is not my problem. Then they sort it out. No. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was once looking at his grandson. And he said, إِنَّ بَنِي هَذَا سَيِّدٌ وَلَعَلَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَنْ يُصْلِحَ بِهِ بَيْنَ فِئَتَيْنِ عَظِيمَيْنِ مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. He looked at Sayyidina Hassan رضي الله عنه, who was his grandson. And he said, I mean, this was now when he was still very, very young. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was addressing the Sahaba in the Masjid. And he said, looking at his son, the grandson, and he said, verily, this grandson of mine, the Sayyid, chief and master, and he is the chief and he's the master. This is how he addressed his grandson. And he said, may Allah Ta'ala make peace between two great groups of Muslims, inshallah, through him. And it happened so, the time of Sayyidina Ali, radiallahu anhu, when the conflict happened between himself and Ziyad, you know, another Sahabi, you know, who was that time in Sham. When he was in Sham that time, and the Khilafah was in Medina, the conflict that happened between the two of them, and the people, they had their followers, and the other party also had their followers. The person who really came in between, who brought about harmony and understanding and unity between these two fighting groups, was none other than Sayyidina Hassan radiyallahu anhu. This was through the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so, when we do find ourselves in that position, then we have to make it our duty to see that peace prevails, that we bring the two parties together. We bring the two parties together, inshallah, so that they might understand one another. You know, the English saying goes, such as you might know better than me, life is too short to have problems in our lives. Life is too short. Well, that's what the Kuffar say. We have to listen to what the Quran says. What the Quran says, and of course the Quran is the best of guidance that one should follow. Now Allah Ta'ala says, if two parties cannot see eye to eye, then it is our duty, فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Allah Ta'ala says, أَصْلِحُوا, make sulh, bring understanding, peace upon them, sulh, which is peace amongst the two factions. فَإِنْ بَغَدْ يَحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى. But if one of them outrages against the other, then fight you all against the one that which outrages to complies with the command of Allah Ta'ala. Of course, you've got to also have an understanding, and you've got to verify, as we've said before, the previous ayah, you've got to go into the matter, into the details of the matter, not to take sides, but to be, you know, you've got to be honest and you've got to be just in your hukum amongst, you know, the two different groups. Otherwise, you might not be fit for that position. And then, of course, you've got to then use someone else. But the main thing is here to bring about peace amongst them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Unsur akhaka zaliman aw mazluma." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Help your brother, whether he is an oppressor or he is oppressed." Now, one might ask this question, and as even the Sahabas couldn't understand, yes, help the one who is oppressed, but the one who is the oppressor, how can one assist him? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained that, and he said that one, whether he is an oppressor or an oppressed one, both of them need help. And he says, the oppressor is help if he oppresses someone, help him also to save him from the position that he is in. Tell him about the seriousness of the matter. If you are an oppressed person or an oppressor, then you also need help. Not the one who is only oppressed. The one who is oppressed, of course, is the one who will suffer. Help him, yes, make things a bit easier for him. But the one who is the oppressor, he needs even more help. Because for what he has put the other one in, he needs more help. Because if you help that person and make him understand what he has brought upon himself, then there will not be any form of oppression coming from his side. فَإِنْ فَاءَتْ فَأَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ وَأَقْسِطُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقَسِطِينَ. Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then if it complies, you are trying to bring that sulh between the two parties,
then make reconciliation between them justly and equitable. Do not side with one of the parties, because then you will be doing unjust, you know, to yourself and to both parties. Do not favor the one party. So here you have to use someone who's got the understanding, someone who's not going to be biased, someone who's not going to favor, but say the haq, even if it is that you might lose his friendship, even if it is that you might, you know, make him feel bad. قُلِ الْحَقِّ وَلَوْ كَانَ بُرْضًا. Prophet says, say the haq, even if it is bitter, even if you might create opposition to yourself, because Allah Ta'ala will guide him, and he will then understand the importance of what you are trying, and he will then follow suit. If you do that, if you are just in your judgment between two fighting parties, Allah Subhanahu, in fact, you know, reward that person. I have to mention this hadith. إن المستقين في الدنيا على منابر من لب بين يدي الرحمن عز وجل بما أقصدوا في الدنيا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, and those who are just between, who give hukum between two parties, if you are just and you are equitable in that what you are giving judgment for, you will be on podiums made of pearls before Ar-Rahman, the exalted and most honored, on account of the fairness in this life on the day of Qiyamah. This is a special reward for that person. So what we understand from this is, do not let it pass by, but make it a duty as from yourself as a Muslim to intervene. Please, my dear brothers, I do not think, you know, a Muslim would ever, you know, just pass by or pass the buck to say, it does not concern me. No, it concerns you. If you do ever see that two Muslimin are at loggerheads, or they cannot see eye to eye, bring the one, أَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. This is the command of the Quran. أَصْلِحُوا بَيْنَهُمَا. Take him and take that one and bring them together and tell them the importance of unity in Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al-Muslim akhul Muslim la yadhlimuhu wa la yuslimuhu. The Muslim is the brother of the Muslim. The Muslim is the brother of the Muslim. He is not unjust with him, nor does he forsake him. So if you are not going to give attention to that person, then you are forsaking him. Then you are doing an injustice to yourself. إِذَا دَعَ الْمُسْلِمْ لِأَخِيهِ بِظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ قَالَ الْمَلَكُ آمِنْ وَلَكَ بِمِثْلِهِ. A beautiful hadith. How one should be concerned with the other Muslims. And we are always asked, you know, to make dua for our Muslim brothers. Alright? Now if you make dua for them, they are absent, they are not there. Do you know, if you make dua, according to this hadith, you make dua, oh Allah, guide Muhammad. He's not here, somewhere else. Oh Allah, guide Muhammad. Oh Abdullah. Oh Allah, guide Abdullah. Oh Allah, you know, shower your blessings upon him. You know, there is a malak. There's an angel that says, Ameen. What you say, Ameen. He's not present now. But there's a malak that says, Ameen. Wa laka bi mithlihi. And may you receive the very same things that you are asking for, or the dua that you are making, may it fall upon yourself also. What better? So yeah, you know, when someone always requests dua from you, do not hesitate, because the dua that you make is not only for him, but it is a dua that comes your way also. Here the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described how two Muslims should have, you know, love and unity and understanding and compassion for one another. And he says, to the mu'mineen,
في توادهم وتراحمهم وتواصلهم كمثل الجسد الواحد إذا اشتكى منه عضو تداعى له الجسد سائر الجسد من الحمى والسهر. يلبس صلى الله عليه وسلم. This is how Muslims should live with one another and the feeling and the unity that is to prevail among them. This is the parable of the Muslims in relations to kindness. How they should be with one another, the kindness they should show one another, the mercy that they should show one another, the compassion they should show one another is that of a body. كَمَثَلِ الْجَسَدِ الْوَاحِدِ. It is like a body, the physical body of yourself. When any part of the body goes through aches and pains, then the entire body cannot sleep. I don't think there's a better hadith, you know? No. But sometimes, you know, we are just careless. We don't care what he goes through. It's his thing. That is wrong. Very, very wrong. Yet the Prophet ﷺ tells us the parable of the believers is like, the parable of the believers is like one body. When one part of the body feels pain, the one brother is unfortunate, you must feel it. The one brother is sick, you must feel it also with him. Like our brothers today who are suffering today there in Syria, or in Egypt, or in Bangladesh, or wherever they find themselves, it should reach you, it should bring sleeps like to yourself. If you are a true Muslim, and you are concerned with the affairs of the Muslimin, it should touch you also in a very big way. Alright? When whatever they go through, you must feel it. It's fine for us to say we feel it with them, but you have to do also your bit. You have to also, you know, go out in your way to see that you try and make things more comfortable for them. If you cannot, من رأى منكم منكرا فليغير بيده. If you see the wrong, try and make changes. Try and rectify it. You know, physically, if you have to go there physically, like the one brother that morning, he stood up here and he spoke very well, alhamdulillah, something that should be admired, you know, when he spoke about the assistance that they give there, how they help the people there, and the hardship the people goes through, alhamdulillah, it might not be everyone who might be in his position to do the same, but if you can assist them in your way, do that, and if you cannot come here physically, then at least speak out against him. It must also, you know, concern yourself. Not to say that it doesn't concern you, it has to concern yourself. And if you cannot even do that because out of fear of the authority, whatever position that you might find yourself in, the least you can do is udu'ula, make dua for him. Because that is in fact the weakest, and in your heart you must feel. It with him, it's the weakest form of the three. But something must be done. Yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also says, Al-mu'min lil-mu'min kal-bunyan yashuddu ba'duhu ba'dan. He says, a believer to another believer is like a building whose different parts enforce each other. If you look at the structure that we are in here, and you want to remove one of the walls or the corner there, this structure itself will start to become weakened. And so, if you start to touch on the other parts also, at the end, the whole thing will crumble, the whole thing will fall, you know, apart, and so on. كالبنيان. This is the example the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives about this ummah. He says, if the one is then removed or the one goes through hardship, it makes this ummah weaker. So stand together. Now, how should one behave oneself with one another? Let's go to the second ayah, another ayah. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ من نساء عسى أن يكن خيرا منهن
وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ بِئْسَ الْاِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتُوبْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الظَّالِمُونَ. Allah Ta'ala again brings a very, very important message across to the people of faith and iman. La yasfar, do not scoff, do not belittle. Do not look down upon one another. Do not humiliate one another. Sometimes, you know, this is unfortunately the sickness that we have, because thinking of our position, we might appear, you know, stronger, more powerful, and more money in our pockets, and maybe a little bit more lighter than the other one, then we start to look down upon the others and humiliate one another or belittle one another. This is in direct conflict with the Holy Quran and especially with this ayah. لا يسخر قوم. Allah Ta'ala says, let not a group scoff at one another group. Because the one that scoffs or the one who belittles, he might be smaller. Or the one that you belittle might be greater in the eyes of Allah Ta'ala. And it happens so many times because إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. It is not what, you know, what comes out of your mouth. You might be able to use bigger words. Fine. You might be able to do that. But you don't know the person that you scoff at, or that you mock at, or that you belittle, or that you humiliate. That person might be, in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, more akram, more honored. So you are really wasting your energy in saying what you are saying to the person or attacking him, not knowing his position by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ سُوَرِكُمْ. Allah ta'ala doesn't look at your appearance. But he looks at your heart, وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ, and he looks at your deeds. الْكِبْرُ بَطَرُ الْحَقِّ وَغَمْسُ النَّاسِ. Sometimes the arrogance that we sometimes display, you know, to our brothers, you know, the arrogance that we display, yeah, it is arrogance. الْكِبْرُ بَطَرُ الْحَقِّ وَغَمْسُ النَّاسِ. Arrogance is refusing the truth and belittling people. This was exactly what Qarun did to his people. Qarun was also the same. You know, Qarun was one of the people of Mus, the time of Fir'aun. He was one of his ministers. He had such a lot of riches and people amongst him who lived at that time, those who were weak of iman, wanted to be the same as Qarun. Because the Quran speaks, you know, so explicitly about that. وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْكُنُوزِ مَا إِنَّ مَفَاتِحَهُ لَتَنُوءُ بِالْعُصْبَةِ. So rich he was that so many of the camels had to carry his keys to the treasures that he had. But it was of no avail to himself. Was of no fa'ida for him. At the end, he was destroyed. But he had a kibr in him. La yaskar. Allah Ta'ala, wa la talmizu anfusakum. Do not defame yourselves. Do not defame. Like we see someone, you know, who might not be in the position, and you want to look down upon him and defame him, you are causing harm and you are going in conflict. With the Quran, Allah Ta'ala says, وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Okay. What's the difference between humaza and lumaza? It's a surah in the Quran, and we sometimes, you know, we don't tend to give the attention, inshallah, you know, to these ayat, but it is defamation by action. You know, defamation by action, you attack the person physically, you defame him, you want to insult him, you want to show that you've got more power than him. And lomaza is by mere exchanging of words and telling him his fortune. Sometimes, you know, we tend to feel good about that because we think that we've got, you know, that power and
the strength to do that. But you are fooling yourself because you are going in direct conflict with the Quran. وَلَا تَقَتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. And do not insult one another by nicknames. This is also, you know, sometimes something that we have to bring to our attention. We sometimes mock at one another by calling one another nicknames. Right? The Prophet in the time of the Sahaba in Medina, many of the people who lived in Medina had, you know, nicknames. And the Prophet used to call them. He called some of them by their nicknames. And he was told that he does not love that name. He's not comfortable with the name, the nickname. And then Allah Ta'ala revealed the ayah, وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. And do not call one another by nicknames, because this is against the Quran, especially when the person is not comfortable with the name. If he's comfortable, then might be a different case. But the moment you do not like that, then obviously, you know, one cannot call one another by those nicknames. بِكْسَ نِسْمُ الْفُسُوقُ بَعْدَ الْإِيمَانِ. Even is the name of wickedness after faith. If you call someone, it would have been okay before the person embraced Islam. But the moment you embraced Islam, all those traditions then falls on the side. All those traditions then falls away from you. Now we act according to the instructions of the Quran, and we are then, you know, led by the instructions of the Quran. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu says, never think ill about of the words that come out of the believing brother's mouth. For example, as long as you can find a good excuse for it. Inshallah, another 2 minutes and we open the floor. We say, Sayyidina Umar said, if someone comes to you, you know, might have promised you, now you tell yourself, subhanAllah, this person I have, he's promised me, but unfortunately he never fulfilled that promise. What is your position as a Muslim? What do you do in that case? Do you immediately have to, you know, reject his excuse? No. Muslim doesn't reject the excuse that he puts forward to you. This is akhlaq of the Muslimin. He says, never think ill of that. If he's got a reason, if it can make sense to you, then always accept that, because a Muslim, what comes out of his mouth must be honored at all times. What comes out of the mouth of a believing brother, as long as you find a good excuse for him. So accept his apology. Some of the ulama says you must even go up to 70 times, you know, the apology that he puts forward to you. Now today, the man didn't even open his mouth, then we start to attack him and we refuse to accept the apology of the person if he, you know, did not come up with what he promised to yourself. So, here again, another way of becoming better in ourselves as Muslimin, towards our fellow human brothers, and not to reject. Kullu Muslim ala al-Muslim haram, at the end of this hadith. And if you might have, you know, spoken ill about someone, how do you rectify it? Many a times you find people, they come to you, they speak bad about someone else. But how do you rectify that? Not to rectify it in the sense that you want to be free by him, no, by Allah. Because you've done a great wrong in the eyes of Allah. How do you go about that? The ulama says, what you do is that when you spoke bad about someone, and then you do that again in the opposite way. If there's every opportunity for you to speak good about the person in public, then you do that. If you've done that in public, you've spoken bad about someone in public, then what you do, you speak again if there is any occasion that you find, you know, an opportunity for you to speak good about the person, then do that. But to go to the person and say, my dear brother, you know, I have spoken bad about you, I'm sorry for what I have done, is not the right way. You don't go and apologize to someone whom you have belittled in public. You know why? Because if you go to him, he'll feel even bad. Worse. He'll feel even worse because now he knows what you had on your mind about him. So what you do in that case is, the ulama, you go to a public platform again and you say, MashaAllah, and brother, he is, of course, we do not expect you to overdo it, but if you can pass on a good word about the person, it will be even better. And then you will clear yourself by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you do that. You know, there is this topic, of course, can go on and on. There are so much that we can speak about, but of course, I know you have to go tomorrow to work again. So we will just, inshallah, call it day, and we will ask any brothers who might have, you know, something to ask, and feel free to do that.